So before we get into a quantitative description of the motion of rigid bodies in a plane, let's first try to understand what kind of motions are out there. Okay, so we'll try to get a qualitative description of different kinds of motions. So the simplest kind of motion is what we call translation. So what is translation? Translation is defined as no change in orientation. So what does that mean? So if I have a rigid body, okay, then this rigid body, as it moves in the plane or in the space, is not going to change its orientation. So orientation can be given by orientation of a line. Let's say I have a line, which we obtain by joining two points A and B. And if you look at this line, if this line doesn't change its orientation as this rigid body moves, then we say it is translating. So for example, if this line A and B at next instant is parallel to, you know, how it was initially, and it is same way after another instant. So as long as these lines remain parallel to each other, we say that this rigid body is not changing its orientation. Or in other words, we say it is actually translating. Now the translation can be what we call a straight line translation or a rectilinear translation, or it can also be a curvilinear translation. So in this case, it looks like as if the point A is moving along a straight line path, right? And the same thing is happening with B as well. You could have picked another line. It doesn't have to be A and B. I could have picked the line C and D in this rigid body, and C and D will also not be changing their orientation as this moves. Okay. On the other hand, I could have this rigid body move along a curved path without changing its orientation. Something like this. So in this case, you can again see that if this is my line AB, the line AB is not changing its orientation. It is maintaining its orientation, except that rigid bodies is still allowed to move along a curved path. So curved path doesn't mean that there is no translation, okay? So when you have translation of a rigid body moving in a plane, whether it's rectilinear translation, where every point of the rigid body moves in a straight line, or curvilinear translation, so this is a still translation, but this is a translation along a curved path, then the orientation of the rigid body does not move, does not change. In fact, this is exactly what we have done when we studied the kinematics and kinetics of particles. So when you have rigid bodies moving in a plane and they're only translating, their behavior is such that you don't have to describe the velocity and acceleration of different points because every point is behaving in the same way, which means that you could treat this rigid body actually as a particle because every point has same velocity and same acceleration because of its motion, which is a pure translation. We will see quantitatively as to how that happens, how do we see that velocity and acceleration for every point is same for a translating rigid body. The second kind of motion is rotation about a fixed axis. So rotation about a fixed axis is the kind of motion where if you take a rigid body, you can pick a point on this rigid body and you can pass an axis through this point, and that could be created if you create a hinge joint right over here. Then this rigid body is now allowed to rotate about the point O. So if you look at the motion of any point on this rigid body, every point will be basically traversing a circular path with respect to point O. So O being the center. So this is the distance R, and this point P, let's say, is traveling along a circular path. If you pick another point, let's say Q over here, then this point is also traveling along a circular path with O as the center. So this is rotation about a fixed axis. So there is an axis that goes through point O, and that axis is perpendicular to the plane of this rigid body, and this rigid body is allowed to rotate about that point, right? That's rotation about a fixed axis because there is a fixed point of rotation. A third kind of motion is what is known as general planar motion. So general planar motion of a rigid body is such that there is no fixed point of rotation and there is no translation because the orientation of the rigid body changes. So in this case, let's say I have this line AB inside this rigid body. That line AB is now in this position. Clearly, the orientation of AB has changed. Let's say the line AB with respect to horizontal line is at 90 degrees, so it's vertical over here. It's making some angle theta, which is clearly not 90 degrees. So orientation of rigid body has changed, which means it is not a translation. At the same time, there is no fixed point of rotation, right? There is no fixed point of rotation, which means it is not a pure rotation either. And that means that this rigid body is doing what we call a general planar motion. Now, this general planar motion can actually be obtained by a combination of pure rotation and translation. So for example, I could take this rigid body from its initial position to this new position in the following way. So first thing I would do is I will pick B as my reference point and I will move this rigid body from this point of B to over here without changing the orientation of this. So if I do that, then I will get here and this is how rigid body is going to look like, right? So no change in orientation, which means this line AB is vertical over here. Let's call it A prime. All right, so now it gets over here and choice of point B is pretty arbitrary. I can pick any point as a reference point. And at this instant, now I can have this rigid body rotated by an angle theta such that A prime actually goes to, let's say, A double prime. And if I do this, then this rigid body has gotten into its new position, its final position, where it is translated as well as rotated from its initial position. So this is a situation where we have a combination of translation plus rotation. So whenever you have something like this, we say it is general planar motion. Now let's look at a couple of examples. So example one is a motion platform. So what's a motion platform? This is the sort of stuff that you see in carnivals. So you have, you know, a platform where you have seats where people can sit. Okay. And as one of these bars over here rotate, you know, you can go up and down while sitting inside this motion platform. So this is basically a mechanism right over here. We have, you know, a fixed rotational joint over here. This is another fixed rotational joint. This is a pivot. Also known as, you know, hinge or a moving pivot point, right? And then you have this object over here, you know, which is essentially nothing but your motion platform, okay? So we have three rigid bodies of interest over here. We have one over here, we have the coupler or the motion platform as two, and the third one, okay? And let's say that link number one and link number three are equal in length, okay? And initially they are oriented at the same angle. So this is, let's say, theta 0, this is theta 0, 2. So we have a parallelogram over here formed from link number 1 to 2 and 3. And you can also say this is my ground link number 4, which is fixed, which doesn't move. So there are only three links, 1, 2, 3, which actually move over here. So let's look at each of these three links, 1, 2, 3, and ask ourselves what kind of motion they have. Do they fit into one of the three classifications, three categories of motion we have just talked about? Translation, pure rotation about a fixed point, or a general planar motion. So you can clearly see that one is rotating about a point, let's call this point O2. So one is rotating about point O2, right? So this point is basically traversing a circular path with O2 as the center. So one is doing pure rotation. And this is a rotation about O2, right? That's your fixed point. So the axis of rotation is going through point O2 and is perpendicular to the plane of this figure. Link number 3 is also doing the same thing, pure rotation, but this is about point O4, and we'll call this point as O4 right over here. Okay? So 1 and 3 are, you know, fairly straightforward to analyze. Let's look at number 2. What kind of motion does 2 have? Well, clearly 2 doesn't have a fixed point of rotation, right? So is this changing its orientation? Is the motion platform changing its orientation? If it is not changing orientation, then we know that it will be a translation. So how do we figure that out? Well, it's easy to see. If you draw the position of motion platform 2 at another instant, right? So let's say I rotate my link number 1 by a few angles. So it gets over here. Okay, so it gets over here. You know, let's say this becomes vertical. So this point is, let's say, A. This point is B. Now A has come to A prime, which is still along a circular path. So this rotates by an angle, let's say, alpha. So if O2A rotates by an angle alpha, then O4B should also rotate by the same angle alpha, right? So B is traveling along a circular path with O4 as the center. This rotates by angle alpha too, and it gets in this position, right? Now in this position, if we draw the motion platform, the link number 2, by joining A prime and B prime, you can clearly see that actually in this new position, A prime, B prime is parallel to AB. So A prime, B prime is parallel to AB. You move to another position, it's the same story. It's the same story. You have, it's still the same orientation. So the orientation of the motion platform is not changing. So it is clearly a translation, right? But what kind of translation this is? Is this a straight line translation? It is clearly not a straight line translation, because if you look at point A, it is not moving along a straight line. And point A is a point on the motion platform. It is actually moving along a circular path. Same is the case with B. If you look at any point on this link 2, the motion platform, they all are moving along a circular path. So this is a translation, but it is a curvilinear translation. It's a curvilinear translation. Let's look at another example. So what I have drawn over here is what is known as slider crank mechanism. Slider crank mechanism. When you take a kinematics or machinery class, you will learn about different kinds of mechanisms, and slider crank will be one of the popular mechanisms that you will study in that class. So, now, slider crank mechanism is a very interesting mechanism. It is found in a lot of different machineries. It is in your internal combustion engine of your car or the truck. So in your internal combustion engine, you have a piston which basically moves inside the cylinder. So in this case, this is the piston, and this actually moves inside the cylinder. So I have not drawn the cylinder over here. Instead of the cylinder, I have essentially drawn just a fixed link. But you can imagine there is a cylinder which constrains the motion of this piston. And this piston essentially is allowed to move back and forth inside the cylinder, right? Okay. Then you have another link which is known as connecting rod. This is connecting rod. And let me call this to be piston. And the connecting rod in turn is connected to another link over here, which is called crank. Okay, so as the piston moves inside the cylinder, because there is a small combustion of the gaseous and air mixture in the cylinder, and that pushes piston in one direction, and that in turn essentially rotates this crank either in clockwise direction or counterclockwise direction. Right? So of course the crank is not changing its direction of rotation as the piston is moving back and forth. It's the same direction it is going to, you know, rotate in, right? So as this piston does back and forth motion, a straight line reciprocating motion, the crank actually rotates. Okay? So now the question is, what is the motion of this mechanism like, right? And this mechanism again has three moving rigid bodies, right? You have piston, you have connecting rod, and you have the crank, right? So let's first talk about the motion of piston. What is the motion of piston like? Well, all we have to do is draw a line in this piston and see if the orientation of that line changes or not. So if you look at, let's say, this line, you know, we're just going to look at this particular edge over here. The piston is at this instant over here. After a while, let's say the piston is moving towards left, you know, it could be here. And the orientation of this line has not changed. And in this case, it's clear that piston is actually doing what we call a translation. And it's a straight line translation, so we can call it rectilinear translation. Okay, because the orientation of the piston is not changing. Now, when the piston is over here, at this instant, okay, where is the crank? Crank will rotate as a result of the piston pushing the connecting rod, right? So maybe the new position of the crank. So let me label this. So let's say this is point A, this is point B, and this point right over here is C. Okay, so C has moved to C prime, right? B will move to B prime. And B prime is moving along the circular arc right over here. So this may have rotated by some angle, right? And the new position of the connecting rod would be this, right? That would be the new position of the connecting rod. So let me just put this into blue color so you can clearly see that this is the new position of the slider crank mechanism, all right? Okay. So these are the new positions of the crank and the connecting rod. Again, the crank is easy to see. Crank is doing a pure rotation, right? So rotation about A is the connecting rod, which looks interesting now. So connecting rod, what kind of motion does connecting rod have? Well, from this figure, it may look like as if BC, this line, which is basically describing the connecting rod's position initially, which has moved to B prime, C prime. And, you know, from the figure, it may look like as if BC and B prime, C prime are parallel, but they actually are not parallel. If you draw its position at another instant, let's say B double prime, you know, and C double prime may be, you know, over here. Okay, this is where C double prime is, and you draw its orientation of the connecting rod, and that's your crank. Now you can clearly see that these lines are not parallel, right? Which means that the orientation of BC is changing. The orientation of connecting rod is changing, but it is not a pure rotation because there is no fixed point of rotation. So this is doing what we call general planar motion, right? Okay. Let's look at another simple example. Let's say I have a wheel, okay? And this wheel is rolling on a surface, okay? So the wheel is rolling. It is not sliding. It's more like, a, you know, wheels of your car, which are supposed to roll. You don't want them to skip. You don't want them to slip. And we will examine that rolling without slipping condition pretty soon. So let's say this wheel is rolling without slipping, okay? What is the motion of this wheel like? So let's say the wheel is rotating this way, which means that this is actually moving in this direction with some velocity V0. That's the velocity of the center of mass. What is the motion of this wheel like? Is it a rotation? Is it a translation? Is it a general planar motion? So let's draw a line, any line. Let's say this is the line on the wheel. After a while, the wheel would have moved to a new position. Let's say this is the new position of the wheel. Where would this line go? And let's call this line to be OP. Where would this line go? Here is O. P would have moved maybe here, right? So clearly, the orientation of the line OP has changed, which means it is not a translation. But is it a pure rotation? It is also not a pure rotation because there is no fixed point of rotation. If O was fixed, which means that if the wheel was hinged right at point O, then yes, it would be a pure rotation. But since point O itself has moved, this is what we call planar motion.